All right, it's good to have everybody with us this evening. We are very thankful to be here to be able to celebrate a baptism. This is why we do what we do. This is why, from what I understand, why every church is supposed to be commissioned to do is to spread the good news of Christ, lead people to Christ, and introduce them to the family of God through the sacrament of baptism. And so, if we're not doing that, we've become nothing more really than a club to some degree. So tonight, we validate who we are through baptism and celebrating what it is that's going on within the life of Noelle and her family and within the life of Pleasant Hill. And so it's so good to have each one of you with us. You make yourself at home. What's going to happen is we're going to have a word of prayer. The ladies are going to lead us in worship. They have a couple of songs they're going to sing. Then I'm going to say a few words, and then we're going to take Noelle back and baptize her. So that's kind of our layout tonight. So you feel free to worship any way the Lord leads you to worship. Altar's open. If you'd like to pray, you're more than welcome to do so. If you'll stand to your feet and bow your head, let's go to the Lord with a word of prayer tonight. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you tonight, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for the wonderful opportunity to be able to gather together with this body and celebrate a baptism. Father, be able to celebrate the life, celebrate what it is that you're doing in the life of Noelle and within her family. And Father, we're so blessed to be able to be a part of that, when it's a part of anybody who's going through it. And Father, tonight, we ask that your Spirit would just rest upon this service in a wonderful way, that you would anoint it in a very special way, that you bless these that lead us. And Lord, if there's anyone that's here tonight that has never experienced baptism and has never experienced that step of faith to start that relationship with you and been resurrected in your name, I pray that you deal with their heart tonight. Lord, I pray that you wrestle with them tonight about the decisions that they're making in life. And Father, we just give you this time in Christ's name. Amen.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your temple.
you guys can be seated. This next song that we're going to do, excuse me, has become one of our favorites, and I thought it was really appropriate for tonight because it's about taking a step of faith, taking the step out of the No, it's not mine. I didn't drive. It's about taking a step. It's about God calling you and taking a step out in faith. And tonight we get to be with Noelle as she does that. And I just think that it's, you know, it's a great time to celebrate and just a great time to remember, you know, why we're here and that we get to celebrate with her. And so y'all just, even though you're sitting down, y'all just keep singing.
Keep my eyes above the and I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours and you are.
It's a true statement to know that that Christ takes us places that only He can take us. That He does things for us that only He can do for us. There's no matter how hard we try or how determined we might be, there are places that we can't go without Him. He takes us to these places. And salvation being one of those places, into the presence of the Father, is something that He does for us in a place that He takes us. And it doesn't matter how many good deeds you do, or how many names, or how many roll books your names might be on, unless Christ takes you to the Father, you just don't go to the Father. So He does things for us that only He can do for us, and that's what we celebrate tonight. We celebrate what He's doing for us, and what He has done for us, and what He continues to do for us. And so, you know, we talked about this morning about fully depending and relying and understanding that He is where our help comes from, and every good gift comes from Him. And of course, we certainly understand salvation to be the greatest gift that we've received in the name of Christ. And like I said, you coming to the Father with prayers about your children, or prayers about work or your health or troubled times or whatever it might be, unless we go through Him to the Father, we just don't get there. So tonight we celebrate what it is He's doing for us and what only He can do for us. There's a couple of passages that I'm going to read to you tonight. The title is Repent and Be Baptized. And the passages are back to back, and it starts in Acts, and it's Acts chapter 2 is where it is. And if you're familiar with the book of Acts, and you know at this particular time that the Spirit has descended and the day of Pentecost has happened and it has filled the upper room. And those believers that in the upper room that had been there, you know, anywhere from a week to 10 days, they were filled with the Spirit, and they come out preaching, and we see them coming out as different people than what it was that they went in. They went in not knowing. They went in powerless. They went in without answers, and they come out in power, and they come out with answers, and they come out with, you know, answering very difficult questions that were posed to them, and talking about Jesus and with authority, and talking about Jesus with boldness. And they just come out of that room completely different than they went into that room. And here's one of the questions that they get. And we know one who more than anybody else was changed, of course, was Peter. You know, Peter was one who ran away at accusations and was afraid at times and was impulsive at times, and, you know, and had a lot of characteristics that we exhibit today. But if anybody was changed during that moment, it was him. And so he comes out and he preaches this wonderful message to everybody around. And he talks about who Jesus is. He talks about the one that the prophet spoke about. He talks about being born of a virgin. He talks about the Son of Man. He talks about the crucifixion, His death, and His resurrection. He talks about all of this. He summarizes the life of Jesus and the purpose of Jesus to everybody that would hear in that first sermon that He preached. And the question is this. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to their heart, and they said to Peter and to the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" It's a great question. Go back, if you will, to the previous one. It says, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" And it's the question that's still being asked today, maybe not in this particular phrase, or maybe not by this particular wording, but the world still has that question today. When they hear about Christ, or when they hear about the gospel, when they hear about the good things of God and the ways of God and the way God changes and transforms and gives people purpose. When they when they see somebody that's been transformed through the power of Christ, when they see a life that's been turned around, when they see a life that's been resurrected, when they see a life that has hope and has joy and has peace in their life, and they may ask it in all different types of questions, maybe what happened to you or what's going on with you or this, that, or the other. They'll recognize that change that takes place within us, but ultimately their question, it's still the same question that was asked to the apostles when they come out of the upper room. What shall we do? What shall we do? And like I said, that's still the question, and here's the answer. Here's the answer that Peter gave them, and it's still the same answer today. It says, then Peter said to them, repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Peter's answer to the men about, they heard the gospel of Jesus, they heard about the death, they heard about the resurrection, they heard about His purpose, and they heard that He was the Son of God. And so their question was, what do we do about that? And the answer that Peter gives is exactly the same answer today that the church is supposed to be given today. Repent and be baptized. Repent and be baptized for the remission of sins and receive the gift that God has in store for you. Turn your life over to Him. Accept Him as Lord and Savior and just simply receive what He has in store for you. The good things that He has. The gifts of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit and everything that comes along with it. The peace and the joy and the assurance of knowing. The assurance of knowing that you've got that relationship with your Heavenly Father. The answers are still the same. Now, we try to fancy up that answer with all different types of sermons and all different types of songs and all different types of Bible studies and all different types of programs and this, that, and the other and denominational beliefs. And we fancy it up and we confuse it and we turn it and we twist it and we do all sorts of things to it. But today, the answer is still the same. Repent and be baptized. Repent and be baptized. Repent. Turn your life over to Christ. Turn from the direction that you're going to the life that He's calling you and be baptized and receive what God has in store for you. The peace, the joy, and the happiness. And we've watched this happen in children. We have watched this happen in seniors. We have watched this happen in young adults and people who are middle-aged. We've watched it happen in so many people's lives who have come to the conclusion that this is still the answer today, to repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And that's what we're celebrating tonight, baptism. We're celebrating an answer tonight in so many ways. And throughout this year, we've celebrated this answer more than once. We've celebrated it a number of times in so many different age groups. We've celebrated those who have found that answer. That's the answer. And I've always been amazed at how God can reveal that answer to the smallest, to the youngest, to the oldest. I've always been amazed at how He can reveal it to an 8-year-old and how He can reveal it to an 80-year-old and how He can reveal it to a 40-year-old and how He can reveal it to people who are genuinely looking for the answer to the question, what do we do now? We've heard the gospel. We've heard about Jesus. What now? You know, when Jesus has a way, God has a way of revealing that answer to so many people, to everybody, if they choose to accept it, repent, and be baptized. So tonight, we celebrate baptism. It represents a new birth. It represents a cleansing through the blood of Christ. It represents the remission of sins and that we're born again, a brand new creature in Jesus Christ, and that we have found that answer and we have claimed that answer for ourselves. And so tonight, that's why we're gathered. And that's why we're here. So for a moment, we're going to ask Noel to come up on the stage. We have three questions here that we're going to ask. And in those three questions, it confirms and it affirms and it confesses that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. Let me get my questions out here. Here we go. I tell you what, let us pray. Father, we come to You right now. We thank you for Noel and for her family. Father, we know that You have Your hand upon her. We know, Lord, that You have been working in her life in a long time. And You know the journey. You know what it's looked like. You know the pains. You know the celebrations. You know the heartaches that's been involved in this journey. And Father, tonight we're so thankful and we're so blessed that this step is being taken and that You're a part of this, that You have led this, that You have brought this about. And we give You glory for it, and we give You praise for it. And Father, we know We know tonight that you are her God without a shadow of a doubt. And for that, we celebrate that in Christ's name. Amen. The questions I have are, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sins? Do you accept the freedom and the power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? And do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? All right, confession. The Bible says that confession is made unto salvation. All right, at this time, we're going to make our way in here. Tim, if you want to play us something, we will shortly appear in here. All right? Let us pray. Father, we come to you right now and we thank you once again for what it is that you're doing. Father, we thank you for the work of the Spirit, for all that you do for us, for bringing us into that relationship with our Heavenly Father, for making us righteous only through Christ. We give you thanks for that. Father, right now we pray, Lord, that you bless this water, Father, for what it represents, that that cleansing power, Father. We know that only you can do that. And Father, we know, Lord, that only you can take us to this place. And for that, we celebrate that in Christ's name. Amen. Noel, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. We'll get Jeremy and Isaac up here with Noelle real quick. She's Noelle's also joining our church tonight, and so we're celebrating that as well. And and I'm sure many of you know that over the past few weeks, that Noah's family has been going through some very difficult times, or let me rephrase that, are going through some difficult times. And let me encourage you that when you gather together with your friends and family over this holiday season, you lift up a prayer for them, and that God's mighty hand holds up and sustains in difficult times. You know, we celebrate tonight. We're so thankful to have this family as a part of our family, and we need to treat them, I would say like family, but we probably need to treat them better than we treat some of our family, truth be told, and treat them like we love them anyway, whatever that looks like. So tonight, we celebrate that. We're thankful for that from the bottom of our heart. We're going to ask you to come around, shake their hands, tell them that you love them, that you're praying for them. Let me make a couple of announcements real quick. After our service tonight, the children are going to be practicing their Christmas program. In about 10 minutes, there's a community Thanksgiving service that starts at Wesley Chapel. For anyone that would like to go to that, I'm sure that they'd love to have you. So if you'll stand to your feet and bow your heads, let me pray one more time. Then we're going to invite you to come around. Father, we come to you right now, and we thank you for this family. We thank you for what it is you're doing in their life and the way that you're working in them and the light that we see in them. And God, as we go forward, I ask you to help us to be the church to them the way that you've called us to be. Help us to be that support. Help us to be the people that they can trust, that they can lean on, and that will be here for them no matter what. And Father, we know that they will be the same for us. And Lord, we thank you so much for your grace and for your loving hand and for your power. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we'll invite you to come around. Let them know that you